professor José Mário Martins, da Universidade Estadual de Campinas, do Departamento de Matemática Aplicada, meu colega, meu ilustre colega. Ele não gosta que eu fale isso, mas é a nossa estrela lá do Departamento de Matemática Aplicada, trabalho de otimização contínua. Temos conversas interessantes, porque eu trabalho mais com matemática discreta, ele com a contínua. E vai falar um pouquinho sobre otimização e complexidade. Professor Mário, a palavra é sua.
Okay, thank you, Carlile. So I'm going to talk something about complexity in nonlinear optimization. Let me begin with the continuous optimization problem. Is this problem here. I want to minimize a function subject to equality constraints and inequality constraints like this. I am going to assume that if the functions that defy the equality constraints and the functions that define the inequality constraints are as smooth as you need. I mean, continuous, first derivatives, if you need second derivatives, and so on. Okay? Okay, so this mathematical problem needs some algorithms to be solved, and all the algorithms for solving this problem are iterative. There are no direct algorithms to solve these problems in general. And since the algorithms are iterative, during many years, I mean more than 50 years, people was very happy analyzing the algorithms from the point of view of the sequences generated by them. Okay, so an iterative algorithm essentially generates a sequence of points, and you analyze the properties of this sequence. So the things that you like to see in this sequence is that this sequence converges to the solution, but this is very much, this is excessively, you cannot pretend that every sequence converges to a solution. So you are happy proving that some subsequence generated by the sequence goes to a solution. And even less than that, you are happy proving that some subsequence of the sequence generated by the problem, by the algorithm, converges to a point that satisfies some necessary optimality condition. This is the kind of thing that we call a stationary point. Okay? So this is the type of theorem that we like to prove. Every limit point satisfies a suitable necessary optimality condition. For instance, in the case that you don't have constraints at all, which is a particular case of the problem where there are no constraints, in the case where you don't have constraints at all, this usual stationarity condition is that the gradient is equal to zero. Okay? But in this millennium, it became interesting to ask for another question. The other question is, well, if I have a sequence, I am going to stop this sequence in a finite number of iterations, and I want to know how many iterations I need to achieve a given precision, defined in some way. I mean, for instance, in the unconstrained case, I am going to say, well, precision means that the norm of the gradient is smaller than some epsilon. So I want to know how many iterations, in the worst possible case, I need to obtain that the gradient of a point in the sequence is smaller than epsilon. In the unconstrained case. In the constrained case, well, the things are a little bit more complicated because, well, the necessary condition is not that the gradient is equal to zero. The necessary conditions are more complicated, but anyway, in any case, we want to know how many iterations, how many function evaluations, or how much work we need to achieve a given precision. Okay? Okay, so we go directly to an algorithm. Okay? There are some things in the algorithm that you are going to see what they are later. About this P, you don't know what is it, but this x0 is the initial point, okay? For beginning an algorithm, we need an initial point. This point is x0 here. And I am going to assume that this initial point is feasible, that is to say, satisfy the equality and the inequality constraints. If you are not comfortable looking at constraints, forget the constraints in this talk and assume that there are no constraints at all. Assume that the problem is unconstrained, okay? If you are comfortable, look at the constraints, of course. Well, this epsilon is the stopping criterion. This delta you are going to see later. This target is a functional value that is, I would like to achieve. This theta you are going to see later, and this sigma mean you are going to see later, but I say in advance that sigma means regularization parameter, okay? Okay, so we initialized the number of iterations equal to zero and initialized the regularization parameter equal to sigma mean, okay? And first thing that I do, I find some x in Rn, I call this a trial point that satisfies the red conditions that are not here, are in the next slide. But okay, I am computing some trial point with some condition that calculated in some way. And here at step two, I compute the stopping criterion, okay? So it is clear that if there are no constraints, this stopping criterion says that the gradient of the trial point is smaller than epsilon. So if the gradient of the trial point is smaller than epsilon in the unconstrained case, or this other thing in the constrained case, or the functional value is smaller than a given target, I am going to stop. Okay, if I don't stop, I am going to test this sufficient decent condition. I mean, I am going to analyze to compute if the trial point satisfies that the functional value is smaller than the previous one, and not only smaller, smaller minus this thing here. And look at the important thing in this thing here. There are two important things, that here appears epsilon. Epsilon is the stopping criterion. And that here appears also the so-called regularization parameter. Okay? So if this decent condition does not hold, I am going to increase this regularization parameter and go to this point here. Otherwise, I am going to continue at step four, where I say, well, I am happy. If I found a point that satisfies this sufficient decent criterion, I am happy. I am going to say, well, the next iterate is going to be this trial point X, and I continue with the next iteration, and so on. Okay? So this is a typical, not very typical. I mean, it is a modern algorithm, but it is with a typical structure. Okay? And some things that I didn't tell to you what they are, but I am going to tell now. Okay? So which are the red conditions? The red conditions are the conditions that should be satisfied here by the point X that I am calling the trial point. The trial point is a point that satisfies this stuff here. Well, there is something, well, okay, there is here another thing that I am not telling you what is yet, but there is a function M that depends of xk and x, such that this function plus a regularization of order p plus 1, and here for the first time appears p, that p that you didn't know what was. So this function at the trial point x, this function at the trial point x should be smaller than this function at xk. So this strange function here, mxk, is going to be what we call a model of the true function. Okay? So this function here is a model of the true function. It's not f of x, it's a model of f at x, such that this model plus a regularization is better than staying at the point where you were, okay? Moreover, I want that this model of the stress function, the gradient of the model of this regularized function here should be smaller than this thing here. Well, and in the constraint case should be smaller if you add here the combination of the gradients of the constraints that fit well with the so-called KKT conditions, okay? Okay, so I want this, and in the constraint case, I always want that the new point is feasible and the so-called complementarity conditions hold. But the essential thing is this, that I want that the model of the function improves, the model plus regularization improves, and that the gradient of the model plus regularization is small enough with this parameter theta. Okay, so this is the interpretation of the red condition. As I said before, M xk of x is a model of fx around xk. What we are doing is considering the minimization of this model plus the regularization term, and the trial point is an approximate solution of this minimization problem, okay? Well, theoretical result. I am going to assume that the red conditions, that is to say, what I do is the thing that the red conditions say that I am doing. That is to say, I am minimizing approximately a model of the objective function at each iteration. So this is the red conditions. And assume that the blue conditions hold. Well, I didn't talk about the blue conditions yet. Okay, I am going to talk in the next slide. For all the trial points computed at every iteration of k, and then, and here is a complexity result, after at most this number of iterations, the algorithm satisfies the stopping criterion. So let us see what is written here. Here it is said that after this number of iterations, where this CP is a constant that depends of the parameters of the algorithm and depends of the characteristics of the problem, but it is a constant, times the difference between the value of f at x0 minus the target. That is to say, well, the greater is this point, the greater is going to be the number of iterations. This is natural because if we are far from the solution, it is natural that I am going to use, in the worst case, a bigger number of iterations. And times this power of epsilon, it is natural as well that the number of iterations that I need before obtaining a stopping criterion depends of epsilon. I mean, and the smaller is epsilon, the greater should be this number of iterations, okay? Because if the smaller is epsilon, means that I am being more exigent, that is to say, I need more iterations in that case. So after this number of iterations, the algorithm satisfies the stopping criterion. So up to now, it is okay. This is a power of epsilon, but I didn't say what is p. I mean, I kind of said what is p, but I didn't say what is beta at all, okay? So I am going to say now what is p and what is beta, and these are going to be the blue conditions. I mean, the red conditions are the conditions that say what I do at every iteration to obtain a trial point. The blue conditions are going to be the conditions that the problem need to satisfy in order that this nice, well, it seems to be nice. I don't know if it is nice yet. if this nice condition is satisfied. Okay. Jose, before going to the blue conditions, I am going to set another consequence, another result that says what happens not only with the number of iterations, but also with the number of function evaluations. Because, well, to say something about the number of iterations is very nice, but I don't know if the number of if an iteration is very expensive or not. That is to say, if I want to know about work in general, I need to analyze jointly the number of iterations with the work per iteration. And the main thing I am doing, the main thing I am analyzing, I want to analyze in this sense, is the number of functional evaluations. I am assuming that this is the expensive thing that is done in this problem, evaluate the function, okay? So here is the number of evaluations employed by the algorithm before satisfying the stopping criterion. And this number of evaluations is, well, this number here, which is the number of iterations, plus a power of epsilon minus one, but the dominant one is this one, so the important thing is this, that is to say, the important thing is that the number of evaluations is of the same order of the number of iterations as this here. Okay? Okay. So, let me say you which are the blue conditions. The blue conditions are the conditions in the problem. And this condition says in which sense the model M is an approximation of F, okay? For example, when M is the P Taylor polynomial and the P derivatives are beta Holder continuous, okay? So, I am saying here that, in which sense the model really approximates the function, that is a nice thing that I want to have, okay? And an example is that the model could be the polynomial of order P, the Taylor polynomial of order P, okay? And this Taylor polynomial, the P derivative of this Taylor polynomial are Helder continuous with order beta. So in this case, if this happens, these two conditions hold. This condition says that the difference between the gradient of the function and the gradient of the model is smaller than this power of x minus xk. And this condition holds. This condition essentially says that the difference is something weaker than saying that the difference between the value of the model and the model of the function is of the order x minus xk elevated to p plus beta. Okay? So, what I am saying here is that essentially, in the simpler case to be analyzed, what I am assuming about the function is that the P derivatives, the derivatives of order P, are Helder continuous, and I am assuming that the model behaves very similar to the P Taylor approximation of the function. Okay, this is the assumptions I am doing on the problem. Okay, so. This is an idea about the proof, a very brief idea about the proof. In the descent condition, if you see the descent condition, you see that in the descent condition, I ask that the value of the function at the new point should be smaller than this, that the value of the function at the old point, minus this thing here, okay? So in the descent condition, this epsilon elevated to p plus 1 over P appeared. Okay. If instead, as of instead of assuming the Helder condition of the P derivatives, I assume the Lipschitz condition of the P derivatives, which is a stronger assumption. Okay. If I assume this stronger assumption, it is easy to say that after a finite number of increasing the regularization parameter, I am going to obtain this. In a finite number, a fixed finite number, I repeat, if I assume that the P derivatives of the function satisfy a Lipschitz condition, it is a manipulation of the Taylor formula to see that this condition is satisfied in a finite number of iterations, in a finite number of evaluations at each iteration. Okay? Okay, but here I don't want to assume I don't want to assume the Lipschitz condition on the P derivatives. I want to assume something weaker than the Lipschitz condition on the P derivatives. I want to assume only a Helder condition on the P derivatives. And okay, in this case, it can be shown that in a finite number of iterations, in a finite number of evaluations, the number of increasing of the regularization parameter is always finite, but the difference is that depends this value depends on beta and depends on epsilon. Okay, so this is the reason why, instead of a complexity of epsilon p plus 1 over p, I obtain a worse complexity p plus beta my plus 1 over p plus beta. Okay? Observe the following, that if I could obtain this decrease here at every iteration, this would be a finite number. And I would obtain this decrease and this iteration and next iteration and next iteration and next iteration. So in a finite number of iterations, that you can't say exactly which is, I would arrive to the condition that the value f is smaller than the target. Okay. So essentially, it is this number that would have given me the complexity result. Okay. So in the case that the Lipschitz condition does not hold, it is not so easy to show that this is obtained in a finite number of iterations. I obtain that this holds in a finite number of iterations, but depending of beta and epsilon. Okay. Okay. So summing up. Okay. If I have the blue conditions, that is to say, these conditions of the problem, and I have the red conditions, that is to say, these conditions on the model, then I am able to define this algorithm. This is the algorithm that I wrote at the beginning. I am able to define this algorithm, and for this algorithm, the worst case complexity is of the order epsilon to the minus p plus beta over p plus beta minus 1. Okay? This is the thing that I proved up to now. Okay. Previous related results. All the previous related results deal with Taylor models. The result that I showed you is not restricted to a Taylor model. I mean, you can consider that the model of the function is not given by the Taylor formula, it's given by some other thing, okay? So in 2006, Nesterov and Polyak, they proved that using the Lipschitz condition of the second derivatives, that is to say, in our case, p equal to 2, and in the unconstrained case, you obtain this complexity here. Okay, the result that I presented before, this result here is a particular case of the result I presented before, because corresponds to the case that p is equal to 2, and to the case that beta is equal to 1, that is to say Lipschitz condition on the second derivatives, okay? Grapiglia and Nesterov, Grapiglia is not here, but is going to be here tomorrow, I think, okay? Using Helder conditions instead of Lipschitz condition. So using Helder condition of the second derivatives, in the unconstrained case, they proved this complexity for the algorithm that they presented, and this is also a particular case of the result that I presented before. Well, these people here, our team with Philip Tuan, using the Lipschitz condition of the p derivatives in the unconstrained case, we proved that the complexity epsilon holds using Lipschitz conditions. Curtis, Gould, and Tuan this year, using Helder condition of the p derivatives in the linearly constrained case, proved the order of the complexity that I showed before. Okay, so these are the previous result. The meaning of these complexity results are the following. Assume that p is equal to 1 and beta is close to 0. Equal to 0 is forbidden. It does not enter into the assumptions, okay? So in this case, the complexity is this and tends to infinity. With p equal to 1 and beta equal to 1, in this case, the complexity is epsilon minus 2. And this is the case of gradient-like methods, the naive way of implementing Newton's method and many quasi-Newton methods. With p equal to 2 and beta equal to 0, observe that the derivatives are one order superior, but now beta is equal to 0. And that is to say, the worst case, we have the same complexity here. With p equal to 2 and beta equal to 1, the complexity is this one, and this is the classical result about the complexity of Newton's method with third order regularization. P equal to 3 and beta equal to 0 coincide with this. P equal to 3 and beta equal to 1, the complexity is this, and so on. Okay? So, some claims and disclaims about these results is that, well, the main claim perhaps is that the main result reported here can be proved in less than 4 pages. Second claim is that non-Taylor model exists. I mean, sometimes in applications you need to use non-Taylor models. For instance, you can think that the model of the function is the Taylor model plus some other thing that you can compute. This is phi, this should be the same, psi and psi. On the other hand, we are implicitly assuming that minimizing, the approximate minimization of the model subject to the constraints of the problem is easy. That is to say, the work of solving these problems, I am not computing this work. I am not putting in them in my complexity results. So I am assuming that it is easy. I mean, the difficult thing here is to evaluate the objective function and the time that I use in computing the trial point, and even evaluating the constraints. I mean, the constraints are not difficult things. I mean, maybe linear or something. Well, something not very complicated. Okay, so. In this work, our complexity results do not involve constraint evaluations. Okay, so now I am going to talk about an industrial motivation. It is unusual to talk about motivation at the middle of the talk. The motivation should be at the beginning, but this should not be very honest because, in fact, I thought about the motivation after the theoretical results, okay? On the other hand, it is a motivation It is a motivation because if you are going to ask me, well, where are the numerical results? I don't have numerical results, so it is just a motivation, okay? So the motivation is related with the activities of this institution, the CEPID-CMEI. The CEPID-CMEI is a FAPESPI project in which several institutions of the state of São Paulo are involved, like USP, Unicampi, UNESP,
São Carlos.
San Carlos y Suspi. The Federal San Carlos too. Okay, you are right. And it's designated to associate industrial applications with at least non-trivial mathematics, advanced, sophisticated, or non-trivial mathematics. So all the time we try to do industrial applications. At the same time, we want to contribute in a meaningful way with mathematics. Okay, pure of applied. So this is the symbol of the CEPID-CMEI. The coordinator of the CEPID-CMEI is not here. It's Professor Cuminato, that many of you know.
Mario, o microfone caiu.
Caiu? Sonamos. E agora?
Assistência técnica.
Only that?
This
okay. So our problem is broiler production. Broiler production means raising chickens for human consumption. Brazil is the biggest exporter of the world of chicken meat. 40% of all the world exportations come from this country, our country. Thousands of farms produce chicken meat all along the country, and these places where the chickens are grown are small companies, are small farms, although they are all of them dependent of very big exportation firms, very famous one, big exportation firms as JBS and BRF, okay? They are dependent because they sell the production to them, and okay. Okay, this is a broiler house. So the chickens grow in places like this. Here are chickens. This is more or less 200 meters. This is more or less 40 meters. The important thing to improve the production is that the chickens should be happy. So our main preoccupation is to obtain happiness of the chicken. The chickens, they don't live a lot of time, but okay, they need to be happy while they are living, okay? This is a picture that I found in a museum in Serbia, okay? And this is a good symbol for this project because here you have the chicken and here you have the man, and all the two of them are looking to the sky. I mean, they are looking to something superior, and probably the chicken thinks maybe I am in a broiler house. And probably the man is thinking, well, maybe I am in a broiler house as well, so that it is another kind of broiler house, you know. Essentially, the happiness may be recognized by the way the chickens distribute and they move around the broiler house. I mean, they are happy when they are active and they go and eat and they drink and so on in a regular way, okay? Okay. So a startup company that was originated in the activities of CEPID-CMEI has been established with the aim of providing innovative ways of controlling and improving broiler production in Brazilian broiler houses. That is to say, this company began already to work, and maybe is going to be prosperous. Okay. As a part of this process of helping the farms, the broiler houses, and helping them to control the production and so on, we elaborated a model that simulates the lives of all the chickens. This is more or less the number of chickens that we have in a typical broiler house during their lifetime, which is about 45 days. And the idea is that simulation should be used to test different strategies for improving production, because, of course, to simulate different strategies using real things is very, very, very expensive. And, well, okay, to have a simulation model helps you to say, well, what is probably going to happen if I do this, if I do this, if I do this, I modify the dimensions of the broiler house, or many other things. So the idea of this this simulation model was a model where each broiler, each chicken, is considered as a particle, and the interaction between all the chickens are considered and are computed all the time using essentially the kind of techniques that one uses in molecular dynamics. I mean, you can think that chickens are atoms or molecules, and they are interacting with rules similar to Newtonian rules. I mean, that the rules that you use for molecular dynamics are also similar to Newtonian rules, and they are not exactly Newtonian rules, but it is the same idea. Okay, but you need to fit the parameters of such a model. And to fit the parameters involves running the simulation and comparing the results with available data. Okay? So, and a single simulation with this number of chickens uses about 20 hours. A simulation using a computer, the computer that may be used in a farm. I mean, it is not a supercomputer, nothing like that, just a small computer. Okay, the simulation is like this. So an algorithm designed to fit the parameters to data should focus in functional evaluations. I mean, if I want to optimize the fitting of the parameters to real data, the important thing is to save functional evaluations. Doesn't matter what other kind of calculations I do. And the model, moreover, the model should be simplified at early stage of the fitting process. This means that if I am fitting the model and at the beginning my fitting is bad, I mean, I'm not fitting well, it is not necessary that I evaluate the simulation process in all its complexity. I mean, I can reduce the complexity at that point, okay? So these observations lead to this idea. We assume that Y is a set that represents the different levels of complexity, of simplicity or complexity. The complexity should not be used in two different ways. Employed by in a simulation, and the idea is that you are going to minimize, you are going to fit the model in the best possible way. That is to say, you are going to minimize a function subject that the precision is the maximum possible, okay? And well, the constraints. In other words, you are going to find the parameters of the simulation model, and the level of precision which I want to compute the simulation model is such that, well, the constraints hold, and that, well, we have optimization here, okay? So this is the idea. I mean, instead of saying at every time I am going to compute the simulation using the 20 hours that I need to compute the simulation, I am saying the following. No, I am maybe many times I'm not going to compute the whole simulation. I am going to make something simpler. For instance, I am going to consider that the broiler house is smaller and the number of chickens is smaller as well. I am going to advance in this sense as far as I can, and I am only going to compute the whole simulation, which is very expensive, when we are, I am close to the solution. So this is the idea. For working with this idea, I am going to use a thing like this, which is called the merit function in optimization. That is to say, a function where the objective function f and the precision of evaluation of the model are combined, okay? And the algorithm that I am going to use is similar to the algorithm that I presented in the first part of the talk. And on the other hand, it is empired in a type of algorithm called the inexact restoration. This is the idea of the algorithm. The inexact restoration algorithm has a first phase, which is called the restoration phase. In the restoration phase, what I do is to decide a precision of the evaluation of the function such that it is better than the previous precision, and such that the objective function does not is not much worse than the previous one. Then I am doing something that is called to update the penalty parameter. Then I go to the optimization phase. The algorithm has a restoration phase and an optimization phase. In the optimization phase, I compute this new precision that this does not need to be better than the previous one, maybe worse than the previous one. So when I compute this new precision, I analyze if this new precision is sufficiently better than the previous one that I had from the point of view of the value of the objective function and from the point of view of the value of this of the merit function. This is the key point. This is the key point because here, for instance, if at some iterations I am using the model with 10,000 chickens, okay, at this iteration, maybe I want to try less chickens just to make the things more quicker. And if they work well, I accept this new precision. And this is the algorithm, okay? So what we can prove about the algorithm is that first, that in a finite number of iterations, I found a point in which the precision is smaller than epsilon, that is to say, is better than epsilon, okay? I achieved any possible precision. And the number of iterations is of the order of epsilon to the minus one, okay? What I do in the optimization phase? Well, in the optimization phase, we minimize approximately a quadratic approximation of F plus a regularization. And this is very similar. I mean, there are technical details, but it is very similar at the kind of things that I mentioned in the first part of the talk. I mean, in the first part of the talk, I mentioned a general model. I am not considering here a general model. I am considering only quadratic models, but the idea is similar. I mean, I try to reduce the quadratic model plus a regularization, and I am trying to approximately solve the quadratic, the corresponding subproblem. And here we have the result of complexity in terms of evaluations of F. If nu is equal to 2, nu is equal to 2, nu determines the regularization parameter, the regularization exponent. So nu equal to 2 corresponds to the gradient case, I mean the case in which in the optimization phase, I am using something similar to gradient method, to quasi-Newton or something like that. So in nu is equal to 2, the number of iterations that I need to obtain the stopping criterion is of the order epsilon to the minus 2, and this is the logical result. I mean, this is the expected result, because it's the kind of result that it is expected in unconstrained minimization. So the idea of reducing the increasing simplicity at each stage of the problem does not impair this result. And if nu is equal to 3, so this is the case in which we do something similar to Newton in the optimization phase, the complexity is of the order epsilon 1 over epsilon 3 over 2, and at iterations no more than the number of evaluations of F are performed. Okay, in this algorithm, I am assuming always Lipschitz conditions. I mean, I am not caring with Lipschitz or Holder. I am assuming really Lipschitz conditions. So the results you see here are the ones that correspond to Lipschitz results in the general case. Okay. Conclusions. The worst case complexity results for continuous optimization seems to be compatible with numerical evidence, at least qualitatively. Qualitatively means that, well, that it is not quantitative. Okay. it means that, well, what you expect is that a good point of view about Newton should be better than a good point of view about the gradient, and this is also what happens in the case of the result of complexity. I mean, if this were not true, something should be very wrong, because, well, you expect that Newton is faster than the gradient, and so this is what happens, okay? Second, complexity proofs are becoming less complicated every year. This may be good or bad. Good because, well, from the point of view of science, bad because, well, it is easier to prove the results, and everybody is going to prove. Then third, that problems in which problems in which the evaluation of the objective function is very expensive can be handled approximately with meaningful complexity results. This was the second part of my talk. Well, there are many theoretical, practical questions, many possible applications, many different problems to which you can apply these ideas, and so on. Okay. Well, these are some references, but it doesn't matter. Okay.
Vamos agradecer.
That's all.